right, I'm going to talk a little bit about the outdoor data collection and analysis that we did. This was also a very large part of the study and an important part as well. To do the outdoor analysis, there were a number of different steps. We received billing data, both seasonal and broke out both seasonal and non-seasonal use from the billing data that we received from the utilities. The way that we broke out the seasonal use and the non-seasonal use was to look at the average winter consumption, which works very well for places like Fort Collins, Waterloo, Denver, places where it's snowy and they're not irrigating typically in the wintertime. We look at the three coldest months typically, November, December, January, December, January, February. Some of the sites were billing bi-monthly, but typically we'd use the 3 months of winter use and break that out. That was considered the indoor use, and the rest of it was considered seasonal. Places where there's more likely to be irrigation during the wintertime as well, places like Toho, San Antonio, some of those sites, we would break out the average winter consumption, but we also use the data logging analysis and the indoor use from the data logging to help us to confirm what the indoor use was for those sites. The next step in the outdoor use analysis was the aerial imagery that we were provided with by the utilities. Many of that we had very high resolution imagery, and we were able to, and they also provided the lot lines for those sites so that we knew what the area of the sites were. And I'll show you some images here in just a few minutes of what we did for that analysis. We got evapotranspiration data, what was available. Some of the sites actually had evapotranspiration data. For some of the sites, we were only able to get temperature data and more limited data. And so we used a Blaney-Criddle formula to calculate the evapotranspiration data for those sites. And then we also used the flow trace data. We then did landscape analysis. We did a determination of theoretical irrigation requirement. In other words, theoretically what these sites should be using for outdoor application. And then we determined the actual irrigation of those sites and the actual application and the analysis of deficit and excess application. Evapotranspiration is a very critical component of this in determining how much water is actually required on a particular site. Evaporation of moisture from the soil surface and transpiration of moisture from the plant itself, all of which are affected by solar radiation, relative humidity, temperature, and wind speed. So that data is really important as a component of knowing how much water is needed to replace the losses from evaporation and transpiration from the plants to keep the plant material healthy. We've got a very typical landscape here. I don't know which site this is. Actually, I think it's Waterloo. But when we were sent this aerial image, and we were sent the lot lines for this image. And then we have a GIS analyst who goes through and breaks down the various pieces. We have our house footprint here. We have hardscape, that's some kind of a patio area. We've got our turf area, trees and shrubs over here. This site also has a pool. And so each of those are broken down for every one of the sites we have aerial imagery for. And then here's another site that we have with very, very different kind of landscape. Here again, we have a house footprint. As you can see, this is quite a large landscape. We are a very large site. We have a fairly large house with a swimming pool. But if you look at the empty or the vacant lot adjacent to this house, it's fairly clear to see that there's very little variation in the quote landscape. This is really pretty much native. And so at this house, when we're going through and trying to determine how much irrigation should be occurring on this site, it would probably be a fairly small amount. The only area that really is getting any outdoor watering or any type of water use here is the pool, because everything else looks like the empty lot next door. So the analysis can vary tremendously from site to site based on the type of landscape that's there. This is one of the sites that we, one of our study sites that we looked at, and we got average of lot size. We looked at the house footprint, turf area, broke down the landscape. This was a 17,000 square foot lot. The house footprint was about 25% of that, 4,000 square feet. This is not necessarily one of the houses I just showed you, but this is an average for one of our entire study sites looking at all of the homes and all of the house footprints. Turf area is relatively small. It's less than 1,000 square feet. Most of the landscape is in trees and shrubs. We have a little over 600 square feet of low water use plants. Pools averaged about 395. Not all of the homes had pools, but that was the average for pool size. And then our irrigated area was about 4,000 square feet. So the irrigated area is about 25% of the lot size, and the house footprint's about 25%. The reference ET, and I'll talk about ET in a few minutes here, the reference ET for that site was almost 64 inches for 2010, which is the year for which we had billing data. So we needed to make sure that the evapotranspiration data that we had was for the same year that we had billing data, because as most of you know, it can vary tremendously from year to year. We then adjusted for effective precipitation, and that brought the ET down to 58 inches. In other words, some of the precipitation that's received throughout the year replaces some of the evaporative and transpiration losses. For the site that we were just talking about, as you can see here, most of our homes are clustered in this area of less than 15, the lot size of less than 15,000 square feet. The irrigated area, most of the irrigated area is clustered in this area under 5,000 square feet. But we certainly have homes, we've got one of the homes, a couple of them here, that have 60,000 square feet of for the lot size. We have one that has almost 30,000 irrigated square feet of irrigated area. But a couple of these really large homes have almost no irrigated area. So we have quite a variability in the amount of irrigation and a large variability in the lot sizes. The R-squared value is clearly there's not a great fit with this line here. But it's not too bad. You can see clustering of homes in here. That means about 14% of the, or 14% times the lot size plus about 1,400 square feet is what your typical irrigated area is for these homes. And then we have a histogram. Bill had histograms. We also have histograms for the outdoor areas. The median irrigated area was just under 3,000 square feet. The average irrigated area of the homes was closer to 4,000 square feet. So we have some of these larger irrigated areas, some of these homes with large irrigated areas that skew that a little bit towards the higher average. In order to have some idea of how much water needs to be applied to the landscape, we have to have a reference point. That reference requirement is a baseline that's used for a site. So if you imagine that you have a site, that the entire site is planted in turf, it's well-watered turf that receives as much water as it needs to remain healthy. It's typically a stand for residential irrigation. It's typically a stand of cool season grass. That's our reference point. We have to have a starting point in order to know whether these homes are over or under irrigating. If that lot that we looked at previously, the entire lot, that really dry one that we were looking at that had native landscape next to it, if that entire thing were in cool season grass, we would then be able from there to determine what percentage, whether that home was over or under irrigating based on our reference point. So here's just an example of an area where you might have a reference crop. This is cool season turf. It's reasonably long. It's out in the open. It's getting solar radiation, wind, the typical types of things that would cause the maximum amount of evapotranspiration of that particular plant. Then we determine theoretically what the landscape ought to have applied based on the landscape that's in that particular home. In other words, most homes are not wall-to-wall cool season turf, fortunately. They have trees, shrubs, some flower gardens, xeriscape, or low-water use plants. So they receive then a percentage of irrigation relative to that reference point. You might think that turf ought to get 100% of what the reference requirement is for a landscape. But in fact, most sites don't keep their landscape lush and green the way a golf course is. Most landscapes, most homeowners can irrigate it apply about 80% of the reference requirement and still keep a healthy stand of grass. So turf gets about 80% of the reference requirement. Trees and shrubs get about 65% of the reference requirement. Xeriscape or low water using plants about 30%. And because of evaporative losses, pools actually receive about 125% of the reference requirement. We then have to bump up the amount of irrigation that we allow for a landscape to do account for the inefficiencies of the irrigation systems. We give spray irrigation 71% efficiency, and drip is 90%. The reality is most of you at the utilities that have done any kind of irrigation audits know that 71% is really, really, really good for spray irrigation. Many spray irrigation systems are in the 30 to 40% range. But if they're done right, if they're designed well, and they're irrigating efficiently, they should be closer to 71%. And we're trying to optimize what people are using for their outdoor landscape. And then we reduce that amount of theoretical requirement by the amount of the effective rainfall. This is, again, for the one site that we were looking at that we've been talking about previously. We don't have all of the data compiled for all of the sites, so we've used this one site as an example. And here, the average application for the irrigation annual application was 123 kilogallons, but our median is down to 95 kilogallons. That's actually a very different number. And again, we have a few sites here. We don't even have 100% of the homes represented. We have an outlier over here that is applying as much as 290, 270, well over 100,000 kilogallons a year. That doesn't give us any really particular information, and that we don't know how much they ought to be applying. This is the theoretical. So this is, in fact, how much they should be applying theoretically. When we use all of those factors, the size of the landscape, effective precipitation, the types of landscape they have. So theoretically, this is, in fact, what they should be applying. As you can see, most of the homes here, the large percentage of the homes, are applying less than 130,000 kilogallons a year. And then this is the histogram of the annual outdoor use. Let me go back here a second. So this is their actual outdoor use, and we have here the average of 127 kilogallons, and then the median is 88. So here we've got their theoretical irrigation requirement, where the average is 123, and we look at the actual outdoor use, and it's 127. It's really not that far off. So most people are really applying about what they ought to be applying, at least in this particular site. That may not be true for all of the sites that we analyze. So then the next piece that we look at is the application ratio. In other words, the ratio of how much they're actually applying to the landscape to how much they should be applying to the theoretical. If they're close to one, then that means that they're applying approximately what they should be applying to their landscapes. Those who are over-irrigating are applying greater than the theoretical irrigation requirement. Those who are under-irrigating would have an application ratio of less than one. Those applications can be influenced by things like drought restrictions, behavior. There are places where people are very, very familiar with how much they ought to be applying. There are people who are well-educated about that. There are people who are under drought restrictions and are applying less simply because they've been told they have to. There are people that are aware that there's not a lot of water available and they've really reduced their water use. So behavior does affect that kind of thing. We have application ratios. We haven't gotten all of the outdoor information for all of the sites, but we do have application ratios for all of our level one sites that we've gone through here. And we've got Denver, who is almost right on target at close to one. Peel is the same thing at close to one. Clayton County, 20% of their theoretical irrigation requirement. In other words, they're very, very low in terms of how much they're actually irrigating. I believe Renee indicated that I think it was Clayton County that had the lowest percentage of in-ground irrigation systems. And that actually goes along with some of the previous studies that we've done that have shown that people who hand water tend to apply less than people who have in-ground irrigation systems. And this is one of those pieces of information that tends to confirm that. San Antonio was dealing with drought and drought restrictions. They're at about 50%. Scottsdale is at 150 or 1.56, or essentially an additional 50% of irrigation over their theoretical irrigation requirement. So we're all over the map here. If we look, this is our sample group that we've been looking at. This is not our groups as a whole. But if we look at our average for our irrigators at this one site, the average for the entire group, here's our line right here. Let me just explain this. This is all of these irrigators are irrigating in excess of their theoretical irrigation requirement. All of these irrigators are irrigating in deficit of their irrigation requirement. We have 12% of our irrigators that are 100 kgals of irrigating deficit irrigation, less than their theoretical irrigation requirement. That's a significant amount. But we also have, you know, a few irrigators up here that are putting on 200 kgals more than their theoretical irrigation requirement. But the average for the entire group of application is 41 kgal. The average for the excess group is 90 kgallons, so considerably higher. The other piece of this, and this is similar to what Bill was talking about with some of the histograms for the indoor use, is, pardon? Like leakage. That it seems like, well, the vast majority of people aren't over-irrigating, so we don't have a problem here. But again, it's the over-irrigators that end up accounting for a considerable amount of the excess usage. So here we have 61% of our homes that are over-irrigating by 10K gallons annually or less. That's a pretty high percentage. That means that 39% of our homes are applying more than 10 kilogallons annually over what they ought to be using, over their theoretical requirement. But that 61% only accounts for 8% of the over-irrigation. That means that we've got that 92% of the excess water use is being used by that 39% of over-irrigators. So some of the takeaway from the outdoor analysis is that evapotranspiration is data that can be determined empirically for sites. Some sites collected on a regular basis. The Front Range, I think, Lori, you've got ET stations very close to you in Fort Collins. There are a lot of ET stations around the Front Range. Some of the sites have that data available to them. Other sites don't. But it is information that can be determined, and it's important to know in order to have some idea of what kinds of applications should be put on the landscape. Irrigated areas tend to follow a fairly predictable relationship to lot size. And although I just showed you this one site, we found that to be fairly true for all of our sites, our study sites around the country, that there's a fairly close correlation to a percentage of irrigated area to lot size. The theoretical irrigation requirement, if you have your lot size, if you've got your GIS information with the types of planting material that's on a site and your evapotranspiration, you can very readily determine the theoretical irrigation requirement. The actual applications can vary widely based on the behavior of your residents. We saw that even we've talked about drought affecting it, but also preferences. I think particularly Western utilities see people moving from the East Coast that really prefer that sort of East Coast type of landscape, and trying to change that behavior can be somewhat challenging, but is very critical to making sure that you reduce irrigation use. Most customers, however, don't over-irrigate, despite what we tend to think and despite the fact that we look at irrigation as such a high percentage of water use. They're not over-irrigating. That doesn't mean they have an appropriate type of landscape, but they're not over-irrigating for the type of landscape that they have. So in order to get that water use down, you have to then look at behaviors and preferences, really, in terms of the type of landscape. That's the key piece to reducing water use, because people aren't over-irrigating for the type of landscape that they have. And then the majority, again, this is true for indoor use. This is true particularly for leakage. The majority of excess irrigation occurs in a relatively small percentage of customers. So in order to get your water use down, doing wholesale reductions of water use, outdoor water use, watering restrictions, and that sort of thing may not be the best way to go. If you can target your users that are over-irrigating, you're going to get a much bigger bang for your buck.